Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Responsibility Principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes God's principles of responsibility that govern the operation of God's laws, gives examples of the way these principles are built into God's laws, and answers audience questions about the principles. Recorded on the 8th of November, 2016, in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Okay, we come to this interesting and challenging aspect of responsibility principles. Yeah, it's a big problem, this, and you can see why God's done it the way God's done it when you examine this more fully. So let's get started on the responsibility principles. Again, we have a number of terms to define. So we want to see that, again, responsibility principles are will-based and discussed in relation to self-aware beings. Of course, as for the governance principles, all creation has responsibilities. But most of it is instinctual, and therefore they are unaware of the responsibilities they are carrying out. Example of that would be something like the humble fly. It has responsibilities. The responsibility that God's given it is to clean up garbage. That's its responsibility, right? So it's one of its many responsibilities, of course. It has a responsibility to procreate. It has a responsibility to go into stasis when there's not enough food and to then come out of that when there's too much. And so it has a number of responsibilities, but it doesn't know it does. And therefore, it's instinctual. Whereas what we're talking about here is the human soul, not the body or the spirit body, being the self-aware being, ability to express free will. Therefore, we're going to talk about responsibility in relation to the human soul. So don't think the rest of creation doesn't have responsibility. It does, but it's not aware that it's carrying out what it's responsible for. Right? Whereas the human soul can be aware or unaware. Energy definition remains the same. Development definition remains the same. And the power of governance definition remains the same. So it's exactly the same as what we've discussed in the previous presentation of governance principles. So energy is still the same thing. It's all information, energy, emotion, thought, and so forth. Development is still about our living in harmony or out of harmony with God's principles. And power is all about the amount of energy that can be expressed if we're in or out of harmony with the principles. So it depends on a relationship to development. So that's all the same. Now let's get to some new definitions. Nature is each individual human soul's God-given personality, attributes, characteristics, qualities, individuality, and primary fields of interest. So that's what we're calling nature. Everyone right with that? Yep. Now, we come to the two business end, the business end, if you like, of it. Self-responsibility is the law based requirement of, now this is very interesting to see it as a law based requirement. God's imposed this as a law based requirement, right? Of self-awareness. So God's laws require you to be self-aware. God's laws require you to seek truth. They also support you seeking truth, and they support you becoming self-aware. To seek love and understanding of all the principles of love and law. It's a requirement. See, most of you just think it's a choice that you can ignore, but it's an actual requirement. And in desiring it to be a choice that you can ignore, you're basically choosing ignorance and saying, and then later on using ignorance as an excuse. You're basically saying, I didn't know, so I shouldn't have to be penalized by the law because I didn't know. But actually, the fact that you didn't want to know is an issue with God. Okay, so it's about the loving ownership and expression of one's will, desire, passion, emotion, attitudes, intentions, thoughts and actions in harmony with God's principles and laws. So it's the loving ownership and expression of one's will. In other words, God requires you to eventually get to this stage where you own the fact that you are a self-aware being and that you have free will. And to own the fact and then express that fact to the world. God's laws actually require you to do it. And all of God's laws support you in doing it. And all of God's laws actually encourage you to do it as well. So it's very interesting. It's a law-based requirement of self-responsibility. Now, this is where a lot of us have some deep issues, right? Because we're wanting to get out of having that responsibility. Self-aware beings, of which we are, must be given self-responsibility, because if they're not, then they can do a huge amount of destruction. Right? So this is very important. Self-responsibility is something you've got to eventually get to the point where you love to be self-responsible. You love to clean up after yourself. You don't leave your stuff all over the floor anymore. You know? You don't go around smelling like, you know, higher to heaven than everyone around you can't handle you. You don't do that anymore. Right? You're a self-aware being who makes sure that they are self-responsible for every personal condition, including and in particular including their emotional and spiritual condition. Remembering spiritual condition meaning your condition of love, and emotional condition meaning all of the emotions that flow through you. You are also completely responsible for them. And this is where we've discussed emotions plenty of times in the past, and where unhealed, hurt emotions come from. And many of you have gone down the track of blaming your parents for the retention of them inside of you. And it's not their fault, because you are a self-aware being. It's your responsibility to learn how to deal with your emotions, your thoughts, your actions. That makes sense? Yeah, very important. Now, role responsibility, which most of you want without any self-responsibility. But role responsibility is the assignment of specific roles of governance in God's universe dependent upon development of self-responsibility and according to development. So that should tell you that you're not going to get a God-assigned role anywhere in God's universe until you first learn to become self-responsible. Interesting, huh? You can see why, right? If you're not self-responsible, how can you be responsible for anything else? You can't, can you? It's impossible. Okay, so let's look at the principles. It forces the human to be self-responsible. Now, I use the term forces on purpose, right? And the reality is many of you are happy to take self-responsibility for specific things, but then unhappy to take it for everything. Right? But God will eventually force you to take it for everything. And if the forcing doesn't work here on earth, the laws force you. And if the laws don't force you here on earth, what will happen is when you pass, you'll be in such a condition that that you'll become aware of what's happened, and the laws will force you there. It encourages the human to desire self-responsibility. In other words, it gives rewards to those people who are self-responsible. Does that make sense? Now, see here on earth again, role responsibility is given to people who are not self-responsible at all. We notice a lot in spiritual circles, you know. The person's personal life is a mess, but he's up there teaching you about spiritual matters. But his personal life's a mess. Like, he has not even learnt self-responsibility yet. Why is he trying to teach you anything? Doesn't make sense, does it, to listen to a person like that? It allows God to reward true self-responsibility with role responsibility. And notice, God gives the gift of role responsibility to a person who is self-responsible already. It's sort of like, it's almost like self-responsibility is like your P plates. Does that make sense? When you learn how to, with your P plates, and you get pretty good at it, then you get your full license, and that's like rewarding you with some role responsibility as a result. Make sense? Clever little system. It's not a little system though. It's like huge. Yeah. Again, because the human has free will, the human is a bit different than other creatures here. The other creatures are given role responsibility and automatically are self-responsible. Right? All of them are self-responsible automatically, instinctually, and all matter is self-responsible, and all of it are given role responsibilities as a result. There's a, you know, like oxygen has a role. Water has a role. They all have specific roles. But because none of it is intelligent and self-aware, it doesn't know it has one. Only we as humans can see the roles that those things are playing. Okay, interesting? Yeah? Okay. Examples. Let's go back to our gravity and aerodynamics example. So, sole responsibility is enforced upon any person who willfully attempts to break the law of gravity or aerodynamics by using the law to desire to or actually harm themselves or others through negligence or direct action. That's just a long-winded way of saying if a person stands on a building and jumps off, then he's been harming himself through a direct action, is he not? Therefore, there will be a sole responsibility enforced upon the person for taking that action out of harmony with love, out of harmony with life, out of harmony with any of the principles, in fact. So we act out of harmony with any of the principles and we do it willfully, there will be a certain level of self-responsibility attached to that. If we act out of harmony with any of the principles, but we do it through negligence, in other words, our lack of desire to know the principles, then there'll be a different level of responsibility for that. It makes sense, doesn't it? But there is no such thing as no responsibility in those areas. So in other words, if you are negligent to find out about the law and then you use the law to your own detriment, of course the law, being the law, will just act like the law acts. Right? And if you're taking direct action, so if I give an example of gravity, because it's an interesting example in terms of some of these laws and how they apply. So we have gravity, we've got the guy up on the building and he's feeling suicidal, right? We need to have enough floors of the building to make it high enough that it will actually hurt him, right? And he feels suicidal, which is a direct feeling of his own. So he decides to jump off. He hits the ground and dies, right? There are a number of things now that are going to kick in. Firstly, the law of gravity dictates under those circumstances the penalty that the human body can no longer sustain its own life under certain trauma. This trauma has caused the human life to the life of the physical body to die. So one of the effects of this law is that this person no longer has a life on earth. Right? So that's number one. So they die. And we're talking about the physical body there, right? So they die. Now, if it was an accidental thing, that would be his only result. But he would also probably, even if it was accidental, have a few other results, wouldn't he? There'd be a few emotions, wouldn't there? Painful emotions, because any loved ones that he had on earth who are now not talking to him, can't hear him, and he can't interact with, you know, if he's got a partner or a wife or a husband or whatever, you know, they can't make love with each other physically or any of those things. So that's another physical detriment that's affected his life and so forth. So there's going to be quite a lot of emotions, even if he did it accidentally, isn't it? And that's a part of that penalty, if you like, of that breaking that law. Of course, the reality is the reason why a lot of those things are not happening is because he doesn't know other laws. Because the reality is you can still interact with your partner on earth if you knew some other laws and your partner knew some other laws, then you could interact, you see. But he doesn't know those, which is the penalty of not knowing them. It turns out to be that he can't do it. But that's his primary problems, but nothing more other than that. And over a few years or a bit of time, or certainly over the next 20, 30, 50, 70 years, he'll probably meet up with his partner again and so forth. And so it's not a permanent, these are not permanent things that have happened to him. But if he chose to jump purposefully, there's all those things that happen, but on top of that, there's now a heap of soul-based penalties, right, about him breaking the life principle, which are quite severe penalties, actually, on the soul. It was a purposeful desire to break the life principle, driven usually by, probably in this case, rage or anger. Usually most people who commit suicide usually do it to manipulate the emotions of others or to avoid their own emotions in an angry way. And so there's a lot of anger and rage in a soul who commits suicide generally. And as a result of that, they're going to have quite a detrimental effect on the condition of their soul, which is a penalty on the soul. Right? So this is where he's willfully attempted to break the law and he's harmed himself and it was a direct action. Now that's the severest of penalties he can actually get from breaking that law. So can you see the penalties for breaking a law will be dependent upon many things, including the measure of the intention. And remember we said God measures intentions because intentions are mathematically defined and pass through the soul as a mathematical formula, also as an energy system that God can measure. Right? So therefore it's measured. So there you go. If he was pushed, then he would have these same things that if he fell off accidentally, wouldn't he, probably? With probably one other emotion, which is he'd be pretty upset with the person who pushed him, probably. So that might be a negative emotion he also has. But the person who pushed him, they are going to now get all of these soul-based penalties. Yeah, which are even more severe than the penalties from suicide, because you've actually not chosen to harm your own life, you've chosen to harm the life of another, and harming the life of another is not your own is not their decision to do that to themselves, and as a result of that, it's actually even a more severe problem. So a murderer will actually experience more soul-based pain than a suicide, because it's the will of another that they're affecting rather than their own. Does that make sense? So here we have the responsibility principles playing out in our life. We're responsible for every action we take. Yep. And you can see now responsibility obviously now creates this other principle, compensation. There's got to be the relationship between responsibility and compensation, which we'll talk about tomorrow. Okay, so let's look at the law of cause and effect. Ensures individuals discover the relationship between what has happened and what caused that thing to happen or why that thing happened. So the individuals take full responsibility for their will, desire, passion and emotion, thoughts and actions. So it's a great law because it basically demonstrates you take this action, you get this result. This is the action, this is the result. There's a causal relationship between cause and effect. So this is a wonderful thing. It tells you what's going on, allows you to make adjustments in your life. Wonderful law based on responsibility principles too, particularly for the human soul again. If we examine some of the others, the compensatory laws obviously involve responsibility. Ensures individuals discover and receive the rewards for their own individual, collective and collective responsible choices and the penalties for the opposite. So here we go. You can almost say the law of compensation, along with scope, hierarchy and governance, now make the law of compensation. Right. The law of compensation is an amalgamation of all of those laws. Now, I'm not talking about compensation principles, I'm talking about the law of compensation itself, which is an actual law, not a principle. The law of compensation is governed by, not just governed by compensation principles. It's governed by scope, hierarchy, governance, and responsibility principles. Right? So you can see one law may have many principles built into it. Yeah. So what do we learn from this? We'll just skip to what we learn about it. Responsibility principles ensure humans are self-responsible and are given role responsibility in line with individuality and development. Scope, hierarchy, governance, responsibility and compensation form a foundation for principles that apply to future potentials of the human soul. So in other words, in a couple of days' time, we'll be getting onto soul-specific principles. All of those soul-specific principles need these principles, these scope, hierarchy, governance, responsibility and compensation principles, in order to even function. So you could say that the order principles form a foundation for the soul-specific principles. Does that make sense? Isn't it lovely how foundation builds upon foundation, foundation principles, and then we've got the order principles based on foundation principles, and then we've got the soul-specific principles applying to the human soul. Still really some foundation principles, but they're built on an already foundation. It's almost like this in a way, where you've got one set of principles, the foundation principles, and then you've got the next set of principles that build on that, which are the order principles, and then you've got the next set of principles, which are the soul-specific principles, upon which we get to build our soul. Make sense? So this is the foundation ones. This is the order ones. And this is the soul-specific ones. So now we have a real firm, the human soul has been given this really strong, firm foundation for its future by having all of these principles involved in its subsequent development and creation. Very powerful set of laws. Okay, so what do we do with them? What do we do with them? Yes. Well, we want someone else to be responsible, don't we, most of us? For things that we don't want to be responsible for. And then, of course, we have a whole heap of things that we're not actually responsible for, but we want to take credit for. You know, like, oh, that's my child. I'm such a... making that child. Oh, that's so fantastic. And who made the child? Well, let's look at it from a soul's perspective. Firstly, the soul is God's child, so we had nothing to do with that. And then what did we have to do with actually making the bodies of the child? We just had sex for, you know, who knows how long it might have lasted, might be a while. But it only needs to happen for about a minute or less, right? And all of those laws that created that child come from? Oh, so and now we're calling it our child because we want to take credit for something we had no real part in. Interesting, isn't it? We want to be saved as well from the results of our own creations. So I create a whole heap of sin, and it all gets very uncomfortable after that, right? My life is uncomfortable. I'm finding my life real difficult to cope with. And so as a result of that, what do? I create the sin, and then I want to blame someone else for it. Now, if my parents will take the blame, I'll give it to them. But most parents won't, you know, without giving you hell for it, right? So you end up not blaming them. So what's left? Oh, God. Let's blame God, right? If you believe in God, you blame God. If you don't believe in God, you blame nature, right? So you go, say the guys go, you know, yeah, sure, I have sex with all these women and everything, you know, yeah, but that's our nature, you know? You blame nature for it. Now, nature is a very common scapegoat, right? Because nature can't say, I'm not to blame. Yeah. And then it gets even worse. If we believe in God, we then start going, well, God should do something about it. What should he do about it? Oh, he should send me a saviour so I can be absolved of it all this stuff that I did, right? So that's not wanting to take responsibility. Do you think God's going to let you do that? No. You can see a lot of religious teachings are driven by the desire to not have self-responsibility. Ain't that the truth? You see a lot of religions, and there's a lot of laws in those religions that are just about, you must not do this, you must not do that, you must not do this, you must not do that. But then if you do that, then you can be forgiven by believing in the blood of Jesus. So that means that, you know, you can get away with doing it, really, right? Because somebody else has taken responsibility. Do you think God's going to let that happen? Of course not. Not taking responsibility for my emotions, words, desires or actions. Common one, right? I'm angry, but whose fault is it? It's yours, not mine. I'm angry, but it's your fault. You did this, you did that, you did whatever. That's the reason why I'm angry. All right? That's not taking responsibility for my emotions. Yeah? Wanting power without responsibility or development. You know, can you see that both Clinton and Trump are doing that? Wanting role responsibility without self-responsibility. That's very common. Oh, I want to feel like I'm important. I want to feel like people need me or want me or approve of me or whatever. And so what I go around doing is trying to take roles over so that I can feel these feelings that I'm desperate for. But in the end, my whole life's a mess. You know, my relationship's a mess. Everything in my life's a mess. I'm not even responsible for paying my bills or anything else. But that's okay. You know, I'm just this free being, you know, not taking any self-responsibility for my life. And this even comes down to things like, I am shocked about the amount of people who don't even know how to grow a plant, particularly in Western society. Like, the average person in a city has probably never grown a food plant for themselves in their life, their whole life. There are many children today who are adults now, who've been, you know, in the last 20 or 30 years become adults, who have never, ever planted a plant that they could eat. Good example. Never even able to make something that they can actually benefit from for their own food. They want to have other people do that for them, right? Placing people in positions of societal power when they are not self-responsible is a big problem. Looking up to and seeking guidance of truth and love from people who are not self-responsible. Gurus, teachers, counsellors, family. Common, isn't it? Common problem. Yeah. Okay. There we have it. Our self-responsibility issues are quite intense. And I would like to say, though, about role responsibility just before we close with this discussion, and that is role, as you can see from our principle, role responsibility is a gift given to you by God directly. And we will not receive such gifts from God. We might receive them from humans, but we will not receive them from God unless we have self-responsibility. Right? So you might get them from people because they don't have the same requirements as God does, but you will not get them from God. Yeah? Natalie, you would like to ask?
Could you give an example from your first century life of a gift of role responsibility that God gave you?
We will in the Q&A, I think, give some examples. Okay. There's some questions, so we'll give some examples, yeah. Okay. Well, our next talk obviously is the Q&A on the subject, so just give us a few minutes so that myself and Lena can change modes here and then we'll get stuck on the Q&A. All right, so this discussion is Responsibility Principles Q&A. We've got only 30 minutes to discuss, 28 now actually, to discuss some of these questions. So I'll try to choose questions that are a bit more applicable than others maybe. So Christine, let's start with yourself.
I think you've already answered some of this.
I have, but I'd like to do more.
What is role responsibility? Is it only for those who have reincarnated? If not, how does this happen and how are we made aware of our role, if given one? Where would we need to be in our progression to have one?
All very interesting questions, Christine. And there's basically four questions in one here, isn't there? So let's look at them one by one. What is role responsibility? Well, what God has done for all human souls is that, and I did talk about this occasionally in the first century. There's some Bible quotes about it. So it was something that I did speak about in the first century a bit. But here we have a soul, right? Human soul. And it grows in its development. It is now, let's say it's now self-responsible. So it's now completely self-responsible. And definition of self-responsibility, if we just go to it, that is the definition of self-responsibility, the law-based requirement for self-awareness. So this soul is self-aware. It seeks truth. This soul seeks truth. It seeks love. This soul seeks love. This soul understands all the principles of love and law, so it wants to put into practice the principles of love and law that it knows. And it owns, it has a loving ownership of its own self-expression and its own will, desire, passion, emotion, attitudes, thoughts, intentions and actions, right? So that's quite a lot that soul has to do to be there, right? Isn't it? So the soul's now there. It's in this place where it's a self-responsible soul. So it's just self responsible. Okay. Now that of course means that it has obviously now quite a lot of power of governance, doesn't it? As a natural state, because it's already in harmony with lots of God's principles and laws. Therefore it has a natural state or power of governance. It also has as we'll learn later, it's engaging the issues of scope and it's gauging the issues of hierarchy, so it understands these principles. So it's in a pretty good state, this soul. It might not be a celestial celestial kingdom or anything like that. It just might be self-responsible, still not yet at one with God, perhaps, but has developed quite a lot of the necessary characteristics and traits it needs to develop in order to obtain that condition at some time in its future. Right? So there it is. Now, obviously, there are many other souls that are in a less developed state, are there not? Of all kinds of development. So you could say there's some right down here that might be very undeveloped, and there might be some right down here that are like just like little specks almost, that have heavily used their will out of harmony with love, therefore have very little power of governance and so forth. And then there's some who have a bit more power of governance and some that have a lot more power of governance, but less than this soul. right? Because of either them not developing self-responsibility, or because of other factors where they're not living in harmony with development. In other words, they are not developed because they are living out of harmony with God's principles and laws. So what God does is God says, I'm going to make this person, this soul, responsible for these things, helping these people here to get into a better condition. Does that make sense?
Yep.
But this person needs to understand and recognize that that's what God wants them to do. Now, how do they do that? They would have had to have at least got to the stage where they can feel some of God's feelings and intentions. Does that not make sense?
Yeah.
Otherwise, they wouldn't know, would they? They'd just assume the role without knowing, which is what people on earth do. They assume roles over other people without really knowing. That doesn't happen in the spirit world, particularly in the higher spheres. It happens in the lower spheres, like in the hills and stuff, but not in the higher spheres. So God has given this self-responsible person an additional thing, which is a role in God's universe. And in the first century, I said that some will be leaders of 10 cities. Some will be leaders of 5 cities. In other words, they'd be like the mayor of 10 cities or the mayor of 5 cities. And that's all dependent upon these two factors. The first one being that they are a self-responsible being, and the second one being that they're developing their nature in harmony with this issue of development. Right? So it depends on those things, but God gives them a role of governance. And it's a specific role of God asking them to do a job that God would like them to do. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. So that's what role responsibility is. It's a specific assignment of a role, and in particular, each role is for the service. Service to others. Make sense? Can you see already a problem with how we assign roles on earth? We don't see it as a service to others. We see it as others serving us. The complete opposite. But that's not how it is in the spirit world. All of the roles that are assigned are because the person's ready to serve and wants to serve and has the ability to serve, and they have enough self-responsibility to be able to serve. Does that make sense? So they're giving the service to others. So the role responsibility, the first part of the question, what is role responsibility? It's about service to others, becoming self-responsible, and God assigning a specific role. Because you may have the development and also have taken self-responsibility in your life. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay. Is it only for those who have reincarnated? No, obviously not. Right? Every single person in the spirit world who's a leader of 5 cities or a mayor of 3 cities or a mayor of 1 city, they all, none of them are reincarnated, yeah. But they all have role responsibilities. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And if be careful about the term reincarnation, because whenever we hear the term reincarnation, we often are thinking about the way the world defines reincarnation, and that's obviously not what we're talking about. So really what we're talking about there, is it only for those who have returned to earth? The answer is no, it's not. Make sense? It's for everybody. Anybody who becomes self-responsible and, as we said here, develops in harmony with the principles of love, right, obviously is now ready, personally ready to accept the role in God's, you could call it God's organization, couldn't you? Which is really God trying to organize things to help people in their growth so that all can experience God's love in the end. Now, I think I've described how it happens now, yes? And how we are made aware of the role is a good question. How are we made aware of the role? Well, if we're in a lower condition of love and we're not as connected to God as we could be, how we're made aware of the role is a person in a higher role tells us the role. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Yep. So there's many of my friends in the spirit world that I gave an assignment to them because God told me to give an assignment to them. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yep.
And they didn't hear it from God because they weren't in the condition to hear it from God. And they assumed it was just me giving them an assignment, which I don't do.
Yeah.
And the reason why I don't do it is because it's not my right to do it. So I'll only do it if God's indicated it. You see what I'm saying? And that, there's a lot of factors that cause that indication. Okay, so either it's someone in a higher role responsibility that gives the role, or they have a direct communication with God. They're at one with God. Now God can just tell them. I'd like you to do that. You seem to want to do that. Would you like to do it? Yeah, of course I would, because I wanted to do it in the first place. And God gives you the role and off you go and you do it to the best of your ability, to the best of your development. Yeah? So that's how it's assigned. And made aware of our role if given one. Where in our progression would we need to have one? Ah, yes. So the end question was, where in our progression would we need to be to have a role? Can you see?
I can see that.
Yeah. What's it going to be determined by? It's going to be determined by, firstly,
our self-responsibility.
Whether we have self-responsibility, right? So that needs to happen first. Then, of course, there are other principles, which we'll learn about later, about desire. So it's going to depend on desire. Therefore, that principle will kick into play. And then, of course, it will be determined by our power of governance. If we have a low power of governance, obviously we can't be given the role. But that, of course, is going to be dependent on development. And also it's going to be dependent on our nature to a degree. Like, what is it that we love doing? God only wants to give you jobs that you love doing. Does that make sense? That you get some personal satisfaction as well as the service to others, you see? So God will only assign a role based on your nature. You know, what your personality, your individual characteristics, attributes, qualities dictate. So if you're a really passionate musician and you love it and you've done it from your heart your whole life and you're really good at it and you just enjoy it so much and it's pretty much your whole life, God's not going to come along and say, I want you to paint some paintings for people, is he? Because that wouldn't be in harmony with your desires and it wouldn't be in harmony with the nature that God has actually placed within you. He'd want you to do something to do with music, like organising an orchestra of people. So you remember in the Robert James Lee's books, there's quite a few times when there's these ceremonies. And one time was with the Magnetic Chorale, another time was when they, you know, a group of people went from the first sphere to the second sphere and there was a ceremony, right? So who organised the music for that ceremony, do you think? It's a person who had self-responsibility, who had role responsibility, and who had the nature of desiring to be involved in music and as an expression of God's love and so forth. And that's the person who would have got that job. So that wasn't my job. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah, that's their job to do. That's the job or the assignment, the role that God gave them. Make sense?
So would you have to be at one with God to have direct communication?
Oh, no. A person in the hills can have direct communication with God, right? But it's going to be pretty hard for them to hear of any, get any responsibility until they are self-responsible, right? And usually that starts happening around the third or fourth spheres. You start getting a lot of, you know, understanding self-responsibility to a complete degree in the spirit world. And by the time you reach the sixth sphere, you're a pretty self-responsible person. But sixth sphere spirits are not assigned any God responsible roles directly from God. They're all given through people who are connected to God. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And frequently they find their own role and fit in with it based on desire. But it's not the same as having a God-assigned responsible role. Yeah.
Make sense?
Thank you. That's a fairly complete answer to your question. That's good. And we go across to David Rosen.
The first or second?
First question. Yeah, first question. Thanks, mate.
Are role responsibilities inbuilt in each soul and only accessed when we become self-responsible beings?
Yes. Now, good question, because there are parts of role responsibilities that are inbuilt in each soul, obviously, because we're talking about this aspect of nature. Now, nature is what we're classifying nature here as the individual human soul. This is the collective soul. So for myself and Mary, it's both of us together, having a given personality, attributes, characteristics, qualities, individuality, and primary areas of interest. Now, God gave these gifts to that soul. So of course, God's not going to give you those gifts and then say, don't use any of them because I want you to use, do something else for me, thanks. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So he's definitely not going to do that. He's not going to give you a nature only to try to get you to do something that is completely opposite to your nature, right? So this is where the soul who's given role responsibility has to have discovered their nature, discovered themselves and discovered their own nature, you see? So that's important part of being given any role responsibility in God's organization. Determining, finding out what your actual nature is. Now, what I see many of you doing is in complete denial of your nature. Many of you even hate your nature. You act like you hate your nature. When your soulmate comes along, some of you just reject them out of hand because of their soulmate reflecting some of the nature that you don't want to have. I see that happening a lot. So we often hate our nature. Now, the problem with that is that we've got to first discover our nature, because remember, role responsibility is according to one's nature. So if you haven't discovered your nature, how can God assign a role? God can't. You need to find your nature, find your personality, find your attributes, characteristics, qualities and individuality, and feel what that is about and act upon that before God can assign you a role. You get that? It's pretty easy to see. But God hasn't inbuilt you doing that. Because if God had built into you actually discovering that by force, then of course your will would be affected, and God doesn't affect your will. So you can see that the discovery of your nature and the development of your self-responsibility, while they are law-based requirements, they cannot be forced upon you because of you having free will. So there has to be something you choose. Right? So this is, Mary and I have had to choose to see our nature, choose to be self-responsible, and then we're given role responsibility. And exactly the same process applies to you. Exactly the same. Because we're equal, we're no different. So of course the same process is going to apply. Make sense?
Yeah, thanks.
Good question. Deirdre, where are you? Down here, thanks. And the next person after Deirdre, can we do Anna S., which is Arnett, not on that side. So she's on that side. Let me find someone on this side. Dave, is he on this side? Yep, so if you have the mic up, Dave, thanks. Deirdre, fire away.
Why do I have a hard time with wanting to take responsibility or feeling like we are responsible and it's not a dirty, I think I've got, it feels like it's a dirty word, almost as if it's got a punishment connotation.
Yeah, yeah. Why?
Yeah, good question.
Yeah. I don't know why. Why is responsibility a dirty word to most of us? Isn't it because, again, of the human condition?
Yeah. I figured it would be like the human hangover, just what you said before.
It's the same as every other hangover. It's a part of the, hangover from emotion and the human condition. It's a part of the world's definition of love that's been imposed upon us, whether that's from our parents or from society generally. That's why we have a problem with the word. But actually, there's more to it than that too, I feel. And that is, I don't know, most of us seem to have this a very strong desire to have others be responsible for our actions. Yeah. Many of you try to make me responsible for your life or your actions. You know, some people rock up here late and then they tell me that it was my fault. Yeah. When Mary sent out things saying that, sent out emails saying time to arrive at 6:30 and so forth. But, it's not their fault, it's their computer's fault. Or it's not their fault, it's whatever. You know what I mean? That's an indication of a person who just doesn't want to take any self-responsibility.
Oh, that didn't even make sense.
What do you mean?
Just the example didn't make sense to me. Like, it makes perfect sense that if it says 6:30, you'd be here, like, even a bit earlier.
Yeah, but if you can't make it by 6:30, most of us want to make an excuse so that we can avoid the emotion of taking responsibility. So we make excuses for our behaviour. And this is what I see many of you doing in your life. You go, I did that because, when I was a kid, mum and dad did that. Or I did that because I didn't have enough time. Or I did that because I didn't have enough money. Or in other words, I was unloving because. And you guys, half of you, most of you have been doing it every single break, as I pointed out earlier. You get up while I'm still talking. And you did it because?
Of just a fear of having to rush back or something, so other than loving principle.
Correct. So you justify the lack of self-responsibility, blaming not enough time or some other reason for the lack of self-responsibility. Now, I'm the one who's talking and yet I get back on time. I'm the one who's the last one here. And I'm also the first one here, if another session begins, generally. And I always get back on time. It's very rare for me not to. It has to be some extreme circumstance. Mm. And yet I do, and you can't. So that tells me you're just making a heap of excuses. So a lot of it is down to the fact that we like to actually let ourselves off the hook. Mm. Now, why would we be motivated to let ourselves off the hook? Can you see a lot of it's related to fear? We're afraid of getting in trouble, afraid of, something bad happening, something unpredictable happening, something, that we would like to have control over and we no longer have control, so we do it. Mm. So we're motivated by a lot of avoidance techniques, aren't we?
Mm.
Yeah. Mm. Can we blame anyone other than ourselves for them? Not really, can we? Mm. Not really. You really can't blame your parents you can't sit here as an adult and blame your parent for rocking up too late. You know what I mean? Can you really? Unless your parent was in your face and imprisoned you and that's why you couldn't get here. That's probably about the only time you could actually do that. So what I'm saying is for many of us, we have firstly the hangovers related to our unhealed emotional condition. But more importantly, we are lacking in personal will and desire. That's why we don't take self-responsibility. Mm. Right? Mm. That's why we do it. And you can come up with 1,000 reasons to justify it, but do you think they matter to God?
Mm-mm.
You are just not going to get role responsibility until you sort out the self-responsibility issue. That's it. Mm. It's not going to happen. Yeah. Mm. So it's very important to see, yes, there are emotional hangovers from our childhood and so forth that have obviously impacted upon the fears that we have. But our choice to honour fear and avoid self-responsibility is a personal decision that we are responsible for. No one else is responsible for that. It's a personal choice, personal decision.
Mm.
We need to start seeing these things as personal, desire-based decisions. If I lack self-responsibility, I desire to do it. I've got to find why.
Mm.
And I'm saying you've got to find why for your own sake, because when it's a law-based requirement to find why. So you're going to be breaking a lot of laws if you don't find out why. Right? Secondly, you'll never be given this beautiful other thing which will bring a lot of satisfaction and rewards to your life, this role responsibility, you'll never be given it unless you do something about this self-responsibility issue. That's reality. Yeah. So for many of you, you try to make me responsible to discover your emotional condition. That's why you have question after question after question about your emotions. Right? That's an indication that you're not taking self-responsibility in your life. You're not wanting to find out for yourself what those emotions are, what's going on and why, and being honest with yourself and having to be self-analytical and all those other things. Remember, self-awareness is a law-based requirement. I don't have to be aware for you. It's not a law-based requirement. You have to be aware for you. That is a law-based requirement. The fact that I am or can be aware for you is my service to you. But it's not a law-based requirement. You follow?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So this is where we need to see self-responsibility, a big issue, and it's something we need to really have a look at seriously if we want to ever be a part of what God wants to organise for the earth. Now, many of you in the past have come up to me and says, yeah, I want to make this earth a better place. And I'm going, well, hang a sec, you're not even self-responsible yet. How can you make the earth a better place when you can't even make you a better place?
Yeah, that makes a lot more sense now. Yeah, it does.
You've got to first make you a better place, and then you have some capacity to share in making the earth a better place.
Yeah.
Is that not true?
No, yeah, that actually makes a lot more sense now. Yeah.
So many of you want to make the earth a better place without making you a better place. Well, that's like you want a role without having any
self-responsibility.
Yeah. Mm. Man, it's a common thing, isn't it, if you think about it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
G'day. Deidre, Anna S. is next. Dave. Dave, I want Anna S. to be next if we can, and then we'll go to Dave. So sorry about that, Dave. Your second question, Anna.
I imagine you and Mary has been rewarded with role responsibility of being the teachers of divine truth. How could role responsibility look like in the beginning of one's development of self-responsibility?
Yes, so your first part of the question is true. Yes, we have been rewarded with role responsibility for two reasons, not just one. One is that we have developed self-responsibility, and the other is that we have recognised our nature. And you can say there's a third issue, and that is we have made sure we developed. Remember, because it's already also based on development, right? So we have to develop, and that's a personal choice. Recognising your nature, that's a personal choice. Self-responsibility, a personal choice. Once those things are addressed, then a role can be assigned. So that we've had to do that. Does that make sense? Now, regarding role responsibility, what does it look like in the beginning of one's development of self-responsibility? You've got to be careful here because you have to be completely self-responsible before you're given a role.
Okay.
It's not like do a little bit of self-responsibility and then get a role. You have to be completely self-responsible to get a role. Does that make sense?
It does.
So part of your question is, you're asking about the beginning of one's development of self-responsibility. Well, at the beginning of your development of self-responsibility, you're not going to get a role, right?
I see.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. You might be put on probation for a role. Do you know what I mean by that?
Yes.
Yes, there are times when a person sees some of your nature is a certain direction, and you're developing some self-responsibility, and you also now have some development, and so they decide to put you on probation for a certain job and see how you go. See whether you develop what's needed before you can actually get that job assigned to you. Does that make sense?
It does.
Yep, and that makes sense to do even in an organisation, doesn't it? If you had an organisation like a business, wouldn't you do that? You'd go, this person looks like the right person for the job. He seems to do the right thing for the job. He seems to have the right attitude, but let's whack him in the job for a bit and see how he goes with a bit of training and a bit of a bit of help, see how he develops, wouldn't you? And if he got real resistive, what would you do then?
Not giving him the
job. You wouldn't give him the job, would you? And if he demonstrated that he wasn't self-responsible, what would you do then? You'd say, look, you know, you need work on these areas, so go away and work on those areas and then we'll relook at it later, wouldn't you? That's what you would do. So if that's what you would do, if that's what you would do in a practical way, don't you think that's going to happen if for anybody who does anything to do with God's truth? Of course it's going to happen that way too. Does it make sense?
It does.
Yeah.
Thank you.
No worries, Anna. Okay, time-wise, yep, we're now over time, as I suspected. Let's go, Dave. We'll give you one. This will be our last question, Dave. Thanks.
First part.
Yep.
How do responsibility principles encourage the human to desire self-responsibility?
Firstly, by rewarding every time you do take self-responsibility. So actually, all of God's laws have compensatory parts to them that reward you for being self-responsible. Isn't that wonderful? It's like you choose to be self-responsible and all of a sudden the law will reward you for being self-responsible. And the law penalizes you for not being self-responsible as well, by the way. So that's how it's sort of like carrot and the stick a bit, isn't it? Like one's on the stick and one's on the carrot leading you along. And this is how we come to learn the benefits of self-responsibility. If you think about it, in a child setting, if we bring up children, we'd probably do a similar thing with them, not by belting them, but the stick meaning that there's some penalty associated with not being self-responsible. And there's a reward for being self-responsible. And that's how God does it. God rewards you when you are self-responsible. Yeah. So that's the first part of your question.
And the second part, what and how is this done in a positive way versus negative ways such as penalties, pain, etc.?
Yes. So I think I've answered that too. It's by giving you positive rewards for actually taking responsibility. And God does this all the time. Like many of you guys have not yet experienced that because it's rare for you to take some self-responsibility for things. So you don't get to experience the joys that come from it. This one thing that I learned, we're very, very young in this life. It was more of a memory, I suppose, for me than a learning. So by the time I was 4 years of age, I used to clean my entire room. My mum and father never had to ask me to tidy up after myself, clean up after myself, iron my own clothes. Wash my own clothes. I did that by the time I was four as well. And I did pretty much everything that I needed to look after myself, made meals for the family as well as myself. By the time I was five, I was making meals, and I'd say three meals a week. In fact, I got to the stage where I decided I wanted to start being of service. So I did other jobs for others in the family. And then also I made some deals with others in the family, you know, like, so by the time I was five, I had these little businesses going on, and some in family and some outside. So, and there's pictures of me, Mary's seen some of them, of me making art or whatever and selling it and all those kind of, this is because I had a feeling of self-responsibility. I didn't want to rely on other people to get the things I wanted and so forth. I wanted to do all that myself. Does that make sense? And there's so much joy that comes from that. It's an incredible amount of joy that you get out of that. Knowing that you can fully sustain yourself by the time you're 5 or 6 or 7 years of age, you imagine the confidence that gives a child, knowing that they can pay for their food, their clothing, their shelter, and anything else they needed by that age. So by the time I was 10, when I went to work, I earned as much as my father earned. By the time I was 12, I'd earn more. I earned more than my dad did at work. Does that make sense? Only because of this issue. Yeah. Now, of course, they still cared for me and took me to school, and during those times I couldn't work, so I was still relying on them. But at the end of the day, if I had the life I wanted to have when I was 12, do you think I would have been doing that? I would have been off doing my self-responsible thing, doing these different jobs that I wanted to do and so forth. Yeah. So I had a lot of businesses happening as well by that stage, you know, little businesses happening. And I used to pay for family holidays because my parents didn't have much funds. So One time I paid for all of the family to go to Tasmania. Yeah. Another time I bought a camera. My family didn't have a camera or a slide projector or anything, so I bought a slide projector, a camera, and my father has still got the slide projector to this day. Yeah. Along with a lot of slides we took, of course.
Could I clarify something?
Yeah.
Just with regard to the reward, is it the nearest thing I can think of is kind of like the satisfaction of actually being of service to someone?
It's not just a satisfaction. That is a personal emotional reward, but there are actually physical rewards too. Like when you take responsibility for your own life, that's when you will start to have some income that's beyond your living requirements. That's also when you will start to be able to have things like savings of time and energy and effort for doing things. There will be, in time, there will be people come along who want to assist you to do those things just because they want to, because they notice what you're doing, and so forth. There's so many external rewards. Honestly, it's like it's not just satisfaction. But satisfaction and personal worth is a large factor, because you get a lot of personal worth out of looking after yourself. It also means that you don't need other people's projections of worth in order to feel good about yourself. Does that make sense? Because and you're also not afraid, because you know you can generate anything. There's been times in my life where I've had no money, and I've never been afraid of having no money, because I know I can just do something here, do something here, and I'll always get it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So I'm not it reduces the amount of fear that you have about your life as well.
You know you can be in the world standing by yourself, in a sense.
Yes. And so therefore you become less reliant on other people for your survival, and also less reliant on other people for your happiness. Now, many of you are highly reliant on other people for both your survival and your happiness. And that's a very bad condition to get yourself in, because if those people die or pass or they don't like you anymore or any of those things, man, you're instantly destroyed. Right? It's far better if you can be more self-responsible. See, self-responsibility is different than self-reliance. So I've been, we've got to remember that this is not self-reliance. This is self-responsibility. Mm. Yeah, it's lovely, eh? Self-responsibility, can't say enough about it. It's a very, very positive thing to develop, because without it, this can't ever be assigned. Yeah, and myself and Mary have received huge amounts of joy from being given roles that God's assigned to us, but we know that it wouldn't have been done without us first doing this. Yeah. So really, in some ways, you can be proud of yourself and confident in yourself that you've actually done the work needed to be done, so you're off the probation list and you got your license now, you know what I mean? And just like a license, if you've got a car license, gives you freedom, so too self-responsibility, taking full self-responsibility, gives you freedom, actually. Because it engages higher, it allows you to engage higher laws and higher gifts that would not normally be available to you. Yeah. So it's a great principle. It's one of my favourite principles. As the people who work with us regularly know, I am constantly trying to help them become more self-responsible. Yeah. It is one of the most beneficial things you could obtain for your life. So there we have it, the responsibility principles. Obviously, there's a lot of things we could discuss in there, isn't there? Obviously, just like any of these principles. Now, that brings us to the conclusion of our day today, but we're going to continue tomorrow with the law-related attitudes and emotions and the human law hangover. And in human law hangover, you will have the opportunity to ask some more questions there, because we're going to do a Q&A on the human law hangover as well, because we feel we need to spend a bit of time on that. And you can see from some of your questions, like ones you've asked, Deirdre, that there's a lot of human law hangover in the question even. Yeah, so we want to discuss how that's affecting us. And then we'll look at the last of the order principles we're going to examine, which is the the compensation principles. And that and the collective of those order principles form now the foundation for the last 2 days of our discussions with you. So what we'd like to do tomorrow is if you'll be given some more homework at the end of the day. And what do you think we're going to spend most of our time on with the homework? The self-responsibility issues, yes. So obviously we're still going to ask the questions about all the principles and about how we live in or out of harmony with them. But when we get the self-responsibility, we want to spend a bit more time on that because that's an area where we really need to develop some more feelings and attitudes of love in, you'd like to say?
Yeah, no, I just wanted to mention on that point that I can feel how this idea of role responsibility for a lot of us is sort of a bit mysterious and glamorous and, yeah, I want to know what's it all about, what's my role? And yet if you reflect on what Jesus has been teaching you, if we just establish self-responsibility and desire our own nature, that's the mystery solved very easily. Mm-hmm. But also don't get so... The reason we want to focus you back on self-responsibility in the homework is that that's where the important work, if you like, for your own happiness in the long term, for your eternal life, needs to go in, if you can put it in there. And I just noticed in the questions there was a lot of stuff about role and not so much about, well, how do I develop this self-responsibility? Mm. When really, if you think about it, that's the logical place to start, isn't it?
Mm.
Yeah.
Also, when it comes to using your will and desire, obviously there's a huge amount of understanding yourself, your nature in that, and there's also a huge amount of being self-responsible in that, being self-aware. Because remember, self-responsibility was about, if we go back, other way. Yeah. What am I doing? I must have pressed something else. So it's about awareness and seeking, which is all about desire, isn't it? So you can see that there's probably going to be a fair bit about will and desire in your self-responsibility stuff that you need to examine. Do you really want to do it? What do you get out of not doing it? What addictions do you get out of not doing it and so forth? So anyway, when we come to examining that over the next few days, that'll be good, I feel. So thank you again for your time today, guys. And we'll catch up with you tomorrow morning at 11. The start time tomorrow is 11 o'clock.
And just a couple of bits of housekeeping. We can finish and then I'll catch you guys about that anyway. Yeah. Okay.
All right. You want to say the housekeeping?
Yep, sure. I just wanted to acknowledge our camera operators today. They've done an amazing job. Just they stand there very quietly and diligently.
Wave at each other. We'll get out of shot.
Yeah, we've got new cameras this time around and they're going pretty good. And, of course, Lena and Igor are always putting in a lot of work as well. Yep.
Yeah. Thanks.
Another couple of little things. With your law-related attitudes and emotions, you don't have a sheet for it up the back, but you can put any questions you have in response to that outline to the human law hangover Q&A onto those sheets. And is there an issue with getting through the toilets in a 10-minute break for all of you? Do you find that? No. Okay. So it's just anxiety to get there and get back, that is unfounded. Okay, good.
Right.
Just wanted to check. Yeah. All right.
Good day. Well, thanks for your time today, guys, and we'll see you tomorrow.